Hello, I'm Andrew Fiola, a junior at Rome Freight Academy. It's June 6, 2001. I'll be interviewing Mr. Robert Sanderson.
Background?
Yep.
Is it recording?
Yep.
All right. You wanted to start with the background information about
me? Sure. I was brought up in Canada, and as a result of that experience, I was involved in the war in 1939 because the Canadians were part of the British Empire. So that went on until God knows when, but the United States jumped in. 41, Pearl Harbor, and some of my friends who were in senior high school joined up and didn't complete high school and were killed. One was in the Battle of Dieppe, the other one was a RAF pilot. Didn't have a car license, and he was shot down in a Spitfire. So I was endued to this whole thing early on. And after I graduated from high school in 43, I went across the border and enlisted in the Navy and was shipped out in September of that year. My boot training was in Sampson, New York, and then to Bainbridge, Maryland for, am I talking too fast?
No.
Okay, signal school. And I used to look at these guys up at Sampson doing that, and I said, that's the last thing I want to do. That's where I ended up, certainly. So after signal school, I went to another advanced signal school in Connecticut, which was more or less a combat communication school. Not for ships, we issued rifles and all that stuff. And then shipped out to San Francisco. And then from San Francisco to Hawaii and the Johnson Islands, Admiralty Islands, and circle around truck for a little while. And I was never permanent ship's company on any ship. We were always temporary. There was a group of eight of us, then soon to become 12. And we started out on a troop carrier, then we were assigned to a supply ship, and then an LCI, which is a land aircraft infantry. All temporary, moving. And then finally an LSD, which had part of the 1st Marine Division on it with alligators, you know, those ones with the tracks. Mm-hmm. They were amphibious, came ashore. And we run that when the invasion of Pelago began. And that was September 15th, 1945. And we were short of ship communications. They didn't want to use radio unless they had to. So we were there D plus two. And that pretty much pretty quickly brings you up to date. And if you'd like to know about that battle, I've got facts and figures on that.
Yeah, if you'd like to get involved in that.
Yeah. General Curtis said that it would be a 3 to 7 day operation. And Chesty Puller, who was a colonel at that time of the 1st Marine Division, said, sir, you're wrong. It's going to be much more than that. The Japanese have got 10,000 troops, more than that, but they have 10,000 of Royal Marine troops stationed here. There's a lot of them enclaves. He said, you can't see them. He said, we're going to bomb it for 2 weeks. The airplanes will bomb it. We're going to use fire bombs. They said, it'll be not a walk in the park, but it's not going to be tough. I guess D plus five, we landed D plus two. And D plus five, I think they were about 600 or 700 yards in from the beach. And instead of, the estimated 3 to 7 days, it was something like 3 months before the island was secure. And these Japanese soldiers were well trained and they were tenacious and fought every inch of the way. And it was a Bloody Nose Ridge, which is famous. You read that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They'd pop out of there and close those steel doors and open up again and open fire and close them again, and they had to go cave by cave by cave by cave to accomplish their purposes. And Puller was so right that it was unbelievable that he had the foresight and told them that they were very well, much understaffed, especially with infantry. They had about, I don't know, 8,000 troops, I guess, but there was about another 12,000 support people on the beach, like we were, except for a couple nights when there was a counterattack, so they threw us into the line. And I must say that that was an experience. Everybody was shooting at anything. As a matter of fact, the outpost down the way from us killed one of our police dogs, who was a guard dog. If he was moving, that's all you need to do is move. And the land crabs are about that big. They go over helmets and stuff and sound just like a tank. They're crawling over stuff, really. So it's just a wild scene. And I shot a lot. I don't think I shot at anything except noise. Never hit anybody, I'm sure. But so everybody said, well, did I meet Chesty Puller? And I said, yes, I did. And he was walking on the beach one day and he went right by us and said, how are you, boys? We said, good. That was my introduction and departure from Chesty Puller. And you ask about medals or something. I've got just all the ribbons for the Asiatic Pacific and the American medal, the Victory medal. And I've got the one decoration with a star on it for the invasion. And those are all in Florida. And a hat I brought back from the Pacific. All in my, just an old beat-up hat with my signal flags. So do you have any questions, or have I gone too fast? We can go back.
It's fine, speed. Yeah. I just, when you were training, your advanced signal training, what exactly did you learn there?
I mean, in the second?
Yeah.
In Connecticut, yeah. Before, it was pretty much, well, it wasn't pretty much, it was all like ship-to-ship communications, only by signal light. You couldn't, if there was radio silence, there was only one way to communicate between ships at sea and task forces. So on, just by flags or light. And you'd have a whole series of flags you'd run up, and it might say, the flags would say right turn 10 degrees at such and such a time. And everybody would put their flags up three quarters of the way to acknowledge that they'd received the signal. Then the lead ship would two block and they'd go all the way up and down. And that meant now turn. That was what we thought we were going to do. We ended up in a woods up in Connecticut, in the foxholes, and signaling from there. And the radio men were up the way from us, another group, that were doing the same thing. We were issued carbines and so on and so forth. And now we were not Marines. We were still Navy personnel, certainly. And that training went on for 12 weeks before we went to San Francisco. Yeah, about 12 weeks. And I was still doing the same thing I said I didn't want to do, be a signaler.
When you communicated from ship to ship using lights, was that sort of like Morse code? Is that?
Yeah. I should have brought my thing, but how's your, what's your first name?
Andrew.
Still remember it. Yeah. Well, it just didn't leave.
Yeah. When was the first time that you encountered your enemy?
I would say that first with the bombardment going on, we watched that for 2 days, 3 days, and then hitting the beach at 2+D+2. I don't think I could ever say that I saw a live Japanese looking face to face. A lot of dead ones and wounded ones alive, but they were not in combat shape by any means, coming down off the hills and so on and so forth. And the Marine Division was finally relieved by the 81st Army Infantry Division after about 2 or 3 weeks. And it was the toughest fight the Marines had up to that time in the Pacific Ocean campaign. No question about it. More casualties. And certainly by square foot, if you want to measure it that way. And the bombing was just, it was unbelievable. It went on 12, 14, 16 hours a day. And we thought, you know, nothing can withstand that. But the Coral did. The Marines took us under a beating. The Army did, even cleaning up. That was a tough fight.
While you were on the beach, You had to dig your foxholes?
Mm-hmm.
How did you communicate out of them?
Well, what we did was we'd have trenches for the... We had two lights. One was at the end of the trench. But the trenches, you weren't digging deep because of the coral. So you're getting coral to stack up in front of you or back of you, really, not in front. Because you weren't worried about anything from the sea. You were worried about things from your backside. So you packed the coral behind you, and so your head was down below the coral. And your light was run by strong batteries, and the power system finally got a generator so that you could signal the ships and back and forth. There was no flags up ahead, you know, halyards or anything, just plain signal flags, or light, basically light.
When you didn't ever encounter any enemies while you were on a ship? Or?
No, only airplane attacks in the Admiralty Islands. They came over a couple times. And really, it was more of a nuisance raid, I guess. They hit a couple ships, but not big. And the one thing that I've probably forgotten, just as soon forget it, the cruiser Indianapolis was carrying part of the atomic bomb. And then took off after they delivered the bomb, I think it was to Guam. And the captain was accused of not zigzagging, and the Japanese submarine sank the ship. And the Philippines, where they were supposed to report, didn't report the missing for over 3 days. And there was about 800 or 900 guys in the water, sharks. Mm-hmm. So we started to go get them, in an LCI, and we got about 2 hours out of Peleliu, and they turned us around and said, there's enough ships there now, you're not going to be needed. And I saw those poor guys come ashore, part of them came ashore at Peleliu, and we were evacuated to hospital ship. Just a sad, sad thing. Very sad. The sharks, God, I can't even imagine that. And, you know, the good times were like going across the equator, becoming a throwback, and not a polywog. Gave you hell, but it was worth it. And, you know, it's after 3 years, almost 3 years in the service. My family, my father was stationed in Niagara Falls, Canada, with Oneida Service Mess. And when I came back, they had moved back to Oneida. So I never did go back to Canada to live permanently. And when I came back, I went to college. And joined Oneida Service Mess. 36 years with it.
Did you have the point system as well? Like, I know some people in the Pacific had a point system.
Yes. The point system was so many months overseas, et cetera, combat figured in there. And also, I think, whether you're married or single, and that figured in there. And the war ended. I forget how many points I had. It wasn't quite enough to get me home anyway. And but it didn't matter, and that was over. And we didn't believe it was over when we heard the atomic bomb fall. We didn't even know what the hell that was. It was just some kind of a name. And when we heard the president relayed that message and said the war was over, the Japanese and the island who were left didn't believe it. There's still, I think, about 100 of them running around up there that they never did catch till after years. Finally, they gave up. It's just a dumb thing, but it's what it was.
When you were with the Seabees, did you help construct anything? Or?
No. Seabees, I were on a ship with them for a while, but never with them. No, we didn't have anything to do with them directly. They were another branch of the Naval system. They built the airport at Peleliu finally. And that bombing run, planes would take off from the airport in Peleliu, go out to sea, make a little wide turn to port side, come back in, drop out, depth and all that stuff, fire bombs on the crags and all those foxholes they had up there. Just day after day they do that. Corsairs basically were the plane. And it was serious, but Phil didn't bring them out. Had to do it by hand. They were tenacious, as I said.
They resisted a lot then?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Right to the last man, almost. They were frightened. Their people told them that we were, you know, terrible people. We'd kill them anyway, so they might as well die fighting.
Now, when you said you were on the tower,
mm-hmm.
correct? When you fell off, you didn't break one bone in your body?
Not one bone.
Yeah.
I was in the hospital for 5 days and stiff and sore. And I was sore for 2 weeks. And the only other thing I have to be in the fever, the neighbors, they got dengue fever, which is something like a high fever. And so it's very debilitating. And I could never give blood. Because I've had that disease. It's like malaria. Comes back, I know, but it only came back to me once. It was about a year after I got home.
They didn't send you home after that? After
no.
You found?
No.
Just catch you there?
I was still breathing. Yeah. Got a cousin that teaches here.
Yeah. Kelly Gerald.
Yeah.
Yeah, I talked to her.
Did you?
Yeah, she was my teacher last year.
Oh, really? Yeah.
She's nice. She's excited.
Yeah. She's the one that got me into this. Yeah.
The Leyte? You were in Leyte, is that what it is?
The Battle
of Leyte.
No.
You weren't?
No.
Not the Philippines.
Not the Philippines?
No, that was the Philippines. We stopped short of the Philippines. That was the next step.
Okay, because Mr. Ford said you were, but...
No, we...
Mr. Ford's.
We were all ready to go. They got us all packed up and said we had another invasion to make. We were ready to go. We didn't know where. And all of a sudden, they said we weren't needed to go back to your tower and behave. And found out it was Iwo Jima that they needed a backup crew for. Mm-hmm. Luckily. Yeah.
Did you, when you took over an island, did you just like take it really fast and then deport out of it?
Well, yeah, they did. But right at the end there, when they were consolidating at the end of the war, like the Marines had hit like the Guadalcanal. Then they'd reassemble and regroup, get new troops, retrain, take about a year, maybe more, and then they'd go to the next, like the Peloton. They left Guadalcanal, and those guys in the 1st Marine Division were in Peloton. And the 3rd and 4th Marine Divisions were elsewhere, but they always fought a battle and then went back to the training grounds. And then refueled with people and equipment and everything. So all those ships we were on, of course, we kept jumping around the whole Pacific, just one place to another, doing sailing on the ship. Temporary ships company until we got on that LSD and went to Philadelphia, and then it was into the ships. Unfortunately.
So you never saw like combat though? Like
never hand-to-hand combat or anything like that, no.
Because I heard like Japanese fought sometime.
Well, they did. And those up in the hills, we never got up that far. We just were probably 150 yards behind the front lines. A little further than a football field, maybe. When the first wave went in. And it kept increasing, of course. And they counterattacked a couple, three times. And it was not funny, but one night, about 5:30, we were sitting on anything we could sit on and eating some food. And all of a sudden we heard this clank, 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 and somebody yelled, "Tank attack." Everybody threw their food up and ran, every which way, direction. Those two guys bringing in an empty oil barrel to sit on to eat. Everybody said, "Tank attack," and whew. You weren't going to sit there and wonder about it. We left. But everybody said, "Never again do that." lucky they get shot. Anyway.
Did you meet a lot of people over there? That
Yeah, several. We rescued some Indians, real from India. They were on an old ship that was sinking, and they went up and got them and brought them in. They put them in an encampment. Didn't let them go around the island until they found a way to get them off the island. But and also, we were on an LCI occasionally, just signal duty. It was an island north of Honolulu. It's called Babblethorpe. And that had about 30, 35,000 Japanese on it. They used to come down once or twice a month, 50, 60, 100 of them on a raft and try to come back on the island. And so they had to patrol that consistently. But they were, it's one of the reasons Honolulu was taken. But after the war, it was pretty factual that Nimitz was the admiral in charge of the Pacific in that area, and General MacArthur disagreed on Peleliu violently. MacArthur said, no, we don't need it. And Nimitz said, yes, we do. And so Nimitz won, and then they said the war, after the war was over, rather, that that was a war that was not necessary. Peleliu was really not necessary. They both had very strong opinions. Of course, they're both very good at what they did. Yeah.
How did you become involved in the American Army instead of you're from Canada?
Well, we were American citizens. And we, my dad, as I said, moved in 1925 to Canada with the company and was an executive in Canada. Oneida. But we kept our American citizenship. And, my brothers and sisters, a couple of them were born in Canada, and they had dual citizenship. But when the war came along, I could have stayed in Canada, but I chose not to do that. I chose to go and just get involved. And that's how.
You were, so that's how you weren't drafted?
No, I was, no. It's funny, because I went over there, and my induction papers say inducted and enlisted. Because I went over there when I was 18, right after high school graduation. And I think I was 2 days beyond my 18th birthday. And they said, oh, you can enlist. You are now going to be inducted. I said, hey, I came over here to enlist. I don't have to do anything. I can go back to Canada. They said, well, okay. I said, inducted, enlisted. He said, that's a new one. I said, whatever. That's what's on my paper. I looked it up the other day. It's very odd.
Were your brothers involved in the war?
Yeah, but they're younger than I was. They were not, one of them was in the intelligence corps, but he was stationed in the United States. After subversives and so on and so forth. And then the other one was way, he was way after that. And they both went to Holy Cross, the Jesuits. And I went to Bonaventure, the Franciscans, so we always had a little war going on between the three of us.
What were some of the other islands that you held?
Well, the other islands were that we stopped at, Kwajalein. Don't ask me to spell it. It's in the book. We stopped at Tarawa for just a couple of days. Stopped at the Johnson Islands. And we went around Truk, which was an island that had a big, huge system out in front, water. All enclosed by coral, a natural base, and one entrance. And they called it the Mariana's Turkey Shoot. And we got enough carriers over there, they just went over there for about 4 days and just plastered the heck out of it, sunk everything in sight. And I guess it's now a big diving spot that tourists go to go see the sunken ships down in this lagoon. But we didn't really stay long. drop supplies in.
What was your daily, like, assignments, like, duties on a daily basis?
After the conflict total was resolved, then we still had to do our thing on the beach with the ships that were coming in and out, and people landing and taking off, and so on and so forth. But after the tower was built, then it became a regular communication center. Not radio, again, just light and flags. And the radio station was down away from us. And the ships would come in and out, just like those poor guys from Indianapolis arrived, from the tower when they arrived. Some of us weren't away. And we grew from 8 to 16. There always had to be 2, possibly 3 people on watch, 24 hours a day. So we were always had a 6 to 8 hour shift every day, minimum.
Oh, you keep saying that they only slight, why wouldn't they use the radio?
Well, during the invasion, they didn't want the Japanese to pick up the transmissions, which they could have probably done. And when you could use light, you used light, but if something was imminent or urgent, to heck with Japanese, the radios were used, absolutely. But in the meantime, if you could use light, it was the way to go. Early on in the invasion, after that week or 10 days, probably didn't matter much.
After you relayed from the first ship and went to the second, did they kept relaying the message back? Is that how that worked? How did all the ships, like, far away get the message?
Yes, they had convoy, let's say of maybe 30 or 40 ships. I think for the Philippine invasion, there was probably 200 ships, something like that. And you had a Commodore, of course, a head communication ship, and you had flyers up behind you, and beside you. They had the responsibility to keep the message going until the last ship was determined. And then you had, let's say the convoy was going to turn 30 degrees north at 10 o'clock at night. That took probably a huge convoy hours to get to the last ship. So you had to start that early, a couple hours earlier. And radio was so much simpler, very definitely. And if they were fairly certain of their codes, the radio people. And we had codes at the light too, but if they were fairly certain of their codes, if the Japanese had broken them or whatever, they'd use radio. It was just a choice of the leader of that fleet, what he wanted to do. And that light I showed you, there's a 24-inch carbon light. And with that, if you were up on the top of the deck of a ship, you could probably reach the horizon plus, I would say 20 miles. I think, you know, you're up maybe 100 feet over the horizon. And, the arc light is so powerful.
Did you have any emergencies that you had to transmit lights like fast so other people would?
Yeah, if you all of a sudden wanted to, if they wanted more medical supplies and on the beach or whatever, that was a priority. You were asking about some donuts or something dumb like that, which there were some dumb requests. We had a commander who pretty much sorted that stuff out. But, we didn't make that decision. Enlisted them. It was the people who were acquainted with what they were doing. Naval officers, really. Maybe from the academy. Somewhere.
So was it a captain that made those decisions? Or?
Well, it could be a full lieutenant or a lieutenant commander, depending.
Who was there?
Yeah, who was there, who was on duty. how imperative it was, how important it was. And it's that old Army Navy thing, the chain of command.
Did you stay with the same group, or like
same group? Couple out of that group, one got very ill, and they sent him back to the States. If he had meningitis and all things, and another one kept having reoccurrence of malaria, so they were replaced. But there's only one guy in the whole outfit that was hit by a piece of shrapnel that I remember, and that was I think it was pretty close to us. And it was a mortar that landed.
When you change groups, the whole group changed ships and so on.
We went all together. We went from that AKA, which is that supply ship, to the troop ship. We all went together. It was kind of neat. We relieved the guys, the Navy, who were pretty hard pressed. And when we got aboard, eight of us then, we could take watches for them. But we got the troop ship, I remember, it was great. We got good food, went upstairs, and everybody else was down there in the hold, and a couple thousand guys down there. And I was down there for a couple rides, but that's enough. 6 bunks high, and hot, no air.
What was the AKA?
That's probably just like a passenger ship. It's a supply ship. Had booms that you could, get big nets, bring them up from the hold. Could put them on a barge, could go into shore, or a smaller ship. They supplied ships at sea, or they supplied ships or people on the shore, and so on. There was an APA, which is a troop attack ship, which was just that purpose, called the Oneida. And I think somebody told me the captain was from Oneida. His name was Geisenhoff. I'm not sure that that's correct. But that's one of the stories I heard when I was out there. Never checked on it since I was back.
Did you have any interesting encounters with other people?
Having lived in Canada, getting the Canadian and British view of life instead of the American, because for the first 18 years of my life, going to Canadian high schools, grade schools, and so on and so forth. But it was different. They had different beliefs. As a matter of fact, just before I graduated from high school, it seems that everybody loved Roosevelt in Canada, didn't like Churchill. I mean, that was not uncommon to hear. They thought Roosevelt was the greatest guy in the world because he gave those 50 destroyers to the English without Congress's permission. And that was a first. So a lot of things, yeah. But I think meeting other people from around the country was probably very, very interesting. Californians and guys from the Midwest. And I was a pretty naive fellow.
What were your impressions on those kind of people?
I thought different, but more involved with family than maybe the Easterners were. I'm not sure of that. I don't know. I had that idea, but the Midwesterners seemed to have a little more stability. As I met the people, they were older than I was too. I was the youngest guy there. Only 18, going on 19. And, these guys were pretty mature fellows. They were married, some were engaged, and not happy to be where they were. I didn't blame them.
Did you have any, when you came home, a lot of soldiers saved their money to come home and get married? Did you do anything like that?
I saved some money, yes. Get married? No. I had a girlfriend in Oneida, not in Canada, and then I was going over to figure skater in Canada for a while, my senior year in high school, And I was doing some figure skating, believe it or not, and playing hockey. The two didn't mix. And but when I moved to Oneida, I met a girl, and we got married 4 years later when I graduated from college. We have six kids. But they both done well. Our son Jeffrey's a vascular surgeon, and we've got a lawyer in Dallas. Got an architect in Washington. Got an artist or a graphic artist up in New Hampshire. So they've all they've all been good guys. They've worked hard. Yeah, but now we got to see them. We got to travel halfway across the United States. So we had a family reunion, which is off the subject, of course, up at the Adirondacks last summer. With all the grandkids and all our kids, of course. And there was, I think, 28 of us. And we got this place called the Albador. It's on Fourth Lake. 13 bathrooms and 12 bedrooms. I'd have to say once, get out of that bathroom. It was wonderful. Yeah. So, what else?
What's the name of the girl you married?
Barbara.
Did you meet her before you went to college? Or
yes, I met her before I went to college. Yeah. And we moved from Oneida to New Jersey, Oneida Swimmer Smith, and then to Illinois, and to Texas, and back to home.
Anything, like, while you're reflecting back on the war, anything that sticks out of your mind or memory?
Well, the one thing, mathematics was not one of my strong suits. I didn't seem to like it. I went to New York when I was 17 and applied for the V-5 program, which was a naval aviation thing from carriers and so on. And they said, well, you passed everything. Should have some more math. They said, well, I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll send you a 12-week school in Connecticut, and if you come back and pass your math, you go on the V5 program, but you're going to be 18 before you do that. And if you don't pass the math, you can end up in the Army. I said, I want the Navy, so I turned that down. I wasn't sure I was going to pass that math. Trigonometry had me.
What's the V5 program?
Oh, it was just a nomenclature for naval aviation. It was a V6 for this and a V5 for naval aviation. A V6 was officer's training, just designation. That's all. I did not want the Army. Then I wanted the Navy, but I wanted to be on a ship, and I didn't have that either, so I lost it all the way around. Yeah.
Why did you want to be on a ship?
It just was intrigued me. I just thought that would be a way to fight a war, be on a ship, get into big naval battles, and all that glamour stuff.
Were you interested in submarines at all?
No. PT boats. I applied for those. And the guy said, well, do you know anything about boats? And I said, no. He said, do you know anything about engines? I said, no. Well, I'm not going on a PT boat. I said, okay. Yeah. No, I did not volunteer for submarines. I didn't even think about it, honestly. But I probably wouldn't have anyway.
Well, we have 22 minutes right now, so if you want to wrap it up or you want to keep going, go right ahead.
Do you have anything else you'd like to add?
I don't think so. Let me just check here. See if I've left anything out or given any false information. We're across the front line, I get that. Went to rescue the members of the Indianapolis. And,
you can explain some of your pictures if you want.
I'm sorry?
You can explain some of your pictures if you want.
Oh. shell banner, Jackson trench, pop gun. Pretty good. Memory. Mm. Can't remember if my shoe was better. Chesty puller. Five silver stars.
Five silver stars.
Five silver stars. Yep. Yeah, that pretty much covers it. Probably left a lot out, but a lot of minutiae anyway. Yeah. And pictures, I don't know what you want to do with those.
Just explain them.
Oh, okay. That's the big light I was talking about, that you can see by 20 miles if you're up on the ship. That's an arc light, 24 inch.
They bolt them into the ship deck?
Yeah, right, ship deck. This is, happens to be on our tower. So if we had a ship way out beyond the reach by light, we had used that light. If we had something enclosed, we used that light, 12 inch. Just a small light. And there was a 36 power telescope. There's a, one of the mounds where those were the Japanese
bunkers
and the coral. And Bloody Nose Ridge. That's part of Bloody Nose Ridge right there. And there was three beaches in the invasion. The island was, White Beach was here, Orange Beach was here, and on the other side of the island, the Purple Beach. So they had three pinchers going up the island. It's like a big crab's claw. My own was. It's just like this.
Did you have to dig your own foxhole?
Oh, yeah. But you just really, the foxhole was putting that coral up. That was, you know, shelling and everything would loosen up a lot of coral. And you kind of put that around you. And digging coral is not... not fun. No, not fun. No. You can't do much with it, really.
Did they tell you that in training, or did you have to find that out?
No, you had to find a lot of things out. Lots. And I remember we had to watch one night, and I forget the passport. Password was something like, well, movie actor name was, I forget his name. Anyway, that was the password for the hours from 10 to 12, changed every 2 hours. And I was crawling up there to see this guy in the foxhole up in the ridge. And he was in a hole. I don't know how he got there, but he did. And there was the three guys up there from our group. I was a third-class petty officer at that, which meant like a sergeant, as young as I was. And I kept whispering, "Where are you?" Like, you know, come on, Ghostbusters. I don't want to go in. And all of a sudden I heard this clank, clank, clank. And this guy said, "They're coming." I heard his voice. And his name was Red Murtaugh. And he said, "Where are you?" And I said, "I'm down here and I'm not coming any closer to you." I said, "Where's your gun?" He said, "Looking at you." And I said, "That's it." And I said, "Red, I just turn around and look the other way and help him up there." And it was those land grabs going across those helmets down the ridge. This clank, I mean, just absolutely, just unreal. Yeah, so that was, I didn't like that night duty.
Were you given any orders while you're in the foxholes, like to remain until a certain hour?
Yep, till most relief from becoming, and then password, what the password would be. And God help you if you're a god. But you know, a bunch of young kids scared as hell up there doing that. We were behind this, behind the Marine Division by 150 yards, but here, the ridge there up in here, and there's another ridge, and we're the third ridge. And, quite an experience.
What were the passwords like? Were they always like a famous person?
No, there were, sometimes it would be a school, sometimes it would be a, like Jupiter, you know, up in the sky, and they just seemed the officer present would give the password for this certain area for the night. Sometimes it'd be 4 hours. Sometimes, as it wound down, it was every, I think, 6 hours. but you couldn't wander around without it. Or you didn't want to.
Did you always have to say it, like when you came across?
Yeah. If it, especially if in the daylight, it was no problem. Just don't let it. This has been good.
This has been good.
You're doing a good job.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. It's all you, though.
Well,
we appreciate it.
Yeah.
Well, it's been fun. And maybe I can get back for that Tuesday morning thing.
Yeah. We hope you can.
Yeah. It'll be fun.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Very welcome. I even found a parking place.